Let's start the lecture 40, part 2, and the course is corrosion protection methods. So we'll talk on coatings and corrosion protection. Now we have discussed a few aspects of coating. What are the basic characteristics of coating, and then what are the application fields of coating. Now we'll try to talk on different types of coatings, and then also we'll try to see the ways to coat different materials on a particular metal substrate, and then we'll also see the importance of interface. So let's look into those aspects. Now when we talk about classification or types of coating, so it can be divided into two broad groups. One is non-metallic, one is metallic. Now when we talk about non-metallic, it could be either inorganic, organic. And metallic, of course, it could contain zinc coating, aluminium coating, copper coating, nickel coating, or multi-metal coating like alloy coating. Now, in case of inorganic, let us say cement or organic coating, mainly paint. Fine. Now, when you talk about inorganic coating, you can also talk about ceramic. We can also talk about glass. And in the paint, it could be a mixture of inorganic or organic, but mainly the top part, paint has three components. One is mainly two components, primer and then the top coat. The top coat, in between there could be another coating layer which can be considered as intermediate coating. But here again, that paint might contain some inorganic substance like inhibitor, like chromates, or sometimes it might contain sacrificial metal particles like zinc. So broadly, these are the two classifications. Now, if we try to understand from the protection point of view, then there could be four classifications, and in that four, you could have non-metallic as well as metallic. Now, when we talk about from the protection point of view, protection basis, there could be four variants. One is barrier, second is conversion coating, third is anodic coating, and fourth is cathodic coating. Now, if we talk about barrier coating, the barrier coating means it provides barrier to corrosive species or simply corrosives. Now, corrosives, or we can say chemicals helping corrosion. Now, conversion coating, it actually modifies the surface and then subsequently it becomes a base for other coating or painting. Now, anodic coating, mostly it is metallic, and there the coating material is anodic to substrate, and in this case again it is metallic. Here the coating is cathodic to substrate. Fine. Now these are another four types of classifications. Now here, for example, barrier coating can have inorganic component, can have organic component, as well as it can also have oxide components. Conversion coating, mainly phosphate kind of stuff. Anodic coating, zinc, aluminium or cadmium on steel, which are actually anodic in the galvanic series between, if we consider the galvanic series between steel and zinc, let us say normal atmosphere where we have moisture as well as oxygen, there zinc sits below steel, so that zinc can corrode and give sacrificial protection to the steel substrate, provided there is some break in the zinc coating. The most popular one is galvanization, okay, where zinc coating is done on steel substrate. Now cathodic coating, this is interesting because the coating material is cathodic to the steel substrate, like let us say nickel or let us say gold coating. So that time, or tin coating, because the tin can is very popular for beverage, for carrying beverage. Now the tin is, or SN, that is cathodic to steel. Now if there is any break in the coating, then definitely steel will be exposed to the environment or the corrosive, and since tin is cathodic to steel in that, in the galvanic series, in that particular corrosive, tin would not corrode, rather steel would corrode, and it will protect the coating. Now that is not the purpose of the coating. Coating needs to protect the underlayer surface. So there one must care that there should not be any break, or there must not be any break in the coating. Okay. But this is done many a times, it gives you excellent protection, provided there is no break. At the same time, it also gives a look. For example, if we have a gold coating on some substrate, so then it gives you a fantastic look. Okay. But at the same time, it will give you desired protection, because gold is very immune to most of the corrosives, at least atmospheric corrosion resistance or acid corrosion resistance. There it has a fantastic corrosion resistance against sulfuric acid, and that too fuming sulfuric acid, but provided there is no break in the coating. Now we'll talk briefly some of those coatings. For example, if we talk about barrier coating, okay, now it can be divided into four parts. Like one is anodic oxide, okay. Now in the anodic oxide, for example, when we do anodization of aluminium, so it forms Al2O3, and this Al2O3 is very resistant. Sometimes Al2O3 can be coated on steel substrate. Now this Al2O3 has excellent corrosion resistance against the atmosphere. Now sometimes this particular layer contains pores, and that pores is filled with chromate, mainly K2CR2O7 kind of chromate, but this is nowadays this is not justified, because chromate has the negative effect on the health of a human being. Now, this is also falling under inorganic coating. Now, there is specified another one is inorganic . So, for example, if we talk about mostly we can consider hard oxide or ceramic, fine. Now, for example, glass coating, okay. So, this glass coating on steel substrate, it is virtually impervious to water . Okay, so that means it gives you a fantastic protection, but remember this glass is also brittle. One must not see an impact happening during the operation of that particular coated surface. So, then glass coating can get dislodged from the surface because these are brittle. Then we can have inhibiting type of coating. These are mostly inhibitors. See, this is basically in the paint when we mix inhibitor. Okay. So, for example, cinnamic acid is added to paint. So, that time it gives you protection in neutral and basic media. So, this cinnamic acid is acting a very small quantity, this acting like inhibition to the steel substrate. Now, then we can have organic coating, mostly paint. Okay. Now, if we see all the time, metal surface is actually getting covered by something, and that actually gives protection. Remember, the homogeneous distribution is one of the criteria. Then we can have pore free layer, then this particular coating should have resistance to electron flow or ion flow, sufficient strength. So, these are some of the basic traits of those coatings. At the same time, this is interesting, one more interesting factor is compatibility and safety. Okay. So, that is also important, compatibility with the environment as well as safety. For example, we have organic coating or paint, and if it contains chromate kind of substance, then they can actually dissolve in groundwater system, or when rain happens they can get dissolved and then this will go into groundwater system. So, that times it can lead to health hazards. So, those are the factors one must consider. For example, compatibility, I could say that, let us say if we talk about erosion, when there is a serious wind flow, let us say desert region, and that wind flow can actually lead to erosion of the coating, and as well as sunlight can also lead to a chalking kind of failure. Chalking is nothing but a kind of a white powdery appearance on the paint. What happens that the paint contains a binder, and that binder can get powdery appearance because of the sunlight, and then that would lead to a kind of removal from the surface, and it will also give a bad appearance on the surface. Of course, that would also lead to ingress of moisture or oxygen to the metal surface. So we have to also consider the compatibility, which paint would work, which coating would work in some aggressive medium. For example, paint would not work in aggressive acid solutions. So you have to be careful. Now, there are paints, of course, which can be helpful in chloride medium, but for example, phenolic coating. But we should be careful. Mostly, we should go for a metallic coatings, because that can give a better serve purpose to a better resistance to those aggressive effects. But the barrier coating, the major thing is, though these distributions are made, but barrier, as the name suggests, that even metallic coating is also acting like a barrier. Okay, for example, zinc coating. We talk about that. Zinc coating is actually at the same time serving as a barrier, as well as it is also serving as a sacrificial coating. So the coating can have both the characteristics, barrier as well as sacrificial effect. So now, but in general, these are the kind of distribution barrier coating. Now, if we talk about conversion coating, so the mainly phosphatic phosphate coating. What it does, it converts the surface to make it a kind of base for a better painting. So like iron, it can react with 3. It can go into iron phosphate, which is the coating, and this is the conversion coating, because iron is getting converted to this, plus these are other products. Now, this will be sticking to the steel surface. Okay. So, this is conversion coating. In fact, the phosphate coating also gives you a good corrosion resistance. And in fact, atmospheric corrosion resistance can be improved nicely. Now, coming to anodic coating. One example is galvanization or electro-deposited aluminium coating. Sometimes cadmium is also coated, because cadmium has a very good resistance to hydrogen diffusion. Okay, so then cadmium coating is used for protecting the steel substrate from hydrogen embrittlement wherever there is a possibility. Now, one more coating that is also used, which is NIP, nickel phosphate coating, mainly eutectic or off-eutectic, or off-eutectic means that there could be hypoeutectic or hyper-eutectic. So, those coatings can also be possible, and that can also give very good resistance to hydrogen embrittlement. So, these two can give you excellent resistance to hydrogen embrittlement. But this is not part of anodic coating. Okay. Now, galvanization is nothing but zinc coating. Aluminium also acts as sacrificial anode. For example, if you have a steel substrate, this is steel, and then you have a zinc coating, Now, the sacrificial, this is zinc. That sacrificial anode effect of that coating would only come if there is a break. Let us say we have a break here. Metal, that steel is exposed to the environment where we have oxygen and H2O. So, before it breaks, small segment. Now, that is possible, for example, during transit, if one sheet metal which is galvanized is put up on one top another, see, one sheet metal is actually there is a kind of a cascade of sheet metals which are packed. Now, while transit, if there are vibrations, so then there could be erosion between two surfaces, the subsequent two sheet metals. So, then some portion of the zinc might get dislodged, or at times, for example, while putting up for use those sheet metal which are galvanized, if there are accidental scratches. So, then only this break can happen. Otherwise, if there is no break, then it will also serve as a barrier coating, because there is no break, zinc, only surface that is exposed to the environment is zinc. So, the zinc corrosion will guide the overall protection. Now, once there is a break, definitely that sacrificial anode effect will come. Since zinc is actually anodic to steel, zinc will dissolve and this 2 electron will be accepted by oxygen so this is cathodic. So, that would happen in this zone, and this reaction would happen around this. Okay. Now, interestingly, the part which is cathode definitely would not go for corrosion. So, that way zinc will protect it before it is not broken or some break is not found in any of those surfaces. So, then definitely zinc will act as a barrier coating. So, this will serve as a barrier, and once that coating is scratched or something, so then definitely when iron surface is exposed, definitely it will give you sacrificial protection. But remember, if this area is quite large, that if large area zinc is removed, then definitely the protection given by the zinc will be concentrated on those region which is galvanically connected with the zinc. For example, if one case, this is my steel substrate, and let us say in one case the coating layer which is removed like this. So, that means a wide area removal. So, that time protection will only be given to this zone, but center of this, that will get corrosion, that will be corroded. But if it is a small break, definitely it will give you protection like this, what we have shown right now. This is anodic reaction and this is cathodic, and that way zinc will protect the steel substrate. Now, there are other coatings which are actually falling in the category of cathodic coating. So, those are like copper, gold, nickel. Those coatings are actually cathodic to steel. Now, gold coating can also be given on brass material, like let's say brass watch. So on top of it, gold coating can be placed. Now brass has a problem because brass is a copper zinc alloy. Now it can also go for de-alloying. Okay. Now when it de-alloys, the surface becomes pale color or dark color. Mainly because of copper enrichment. Copper enrichment because of zinc dissolution, preferential zinc dissolution. And this layer is porous. And when it is porous, so the light would get absorbed there. So the light would not get reflected nicely from that surface. So it will have a look of a little bit of darkening look, or sometimes it would look like a kind of black spots on the watch casing. So that's what this particular brass watch, at times they are coated with nickel, gold. So those are the coating materials used. Now when you put gold, so this is around 0.1 micron micrometer thick. Now when we put gold serves two purposes. One is definitely look, bright yellow color, and gold is almost about 99.9% pure, so which is almost 24 karat gold. The thickness is very small because the gold, when you talk about a watch, we are not going to put a lot of abrasion action. The major problem is the salty nature of the sweat. So that would lead to a serious pitting kind of corrosion, but gold has its inherent resistance to pitting corrosion, because gold is almost immune. 24 karat gold is almost immune to chemicals like salt solution or even at times acid solution. So that time it will give those protections. Another thing is a barrier. Okay, barrier protection. Fine. Now, interesting part is, if it is broken, so that's not a good situation, a bad situation from corrosion point of view, because let's say we have a brass substrate, on top of it we have a gold substrate. Gold layer, let's say this is a gold layer, and if there is a break, let's say this segment is broken. Now this segment would act as anode, and rest of the gold coated layer would act as cathode. Now here are two situations. One is this is gold, and let's say this is brass. Now this gold has large area cathode. It will act like a large area cathode, and this is a small area anode. Hence the aggressive action of the corrosion due to the dissimilar area factor, or a favorable area factor for a greater corrosion, that is actually prevalent here. So the dissolution of this segment will be far more than a normal circumstances where brass is only exposed to the environment. So it's a very aggressive dissolution. Fine. Okay. So this is one aspect, but these are done for meeting specific purpose. For example, one more cathodic coating is tin coating or tin cans. There also one has to be careful. For example, the food can or the beverage cans, they are actually coated with tin. Now, one important aspect is there one should not have a lot of dissolved oxygen, as well as if possible the moisture content should be low, so that there should not be a possibility of a stronger cathodic reaction like oxygen reduction. So then tin will not dissolve, okay. And tin, and since in a beverage can actually we are not putting any kind of abrasive action, so the protection provided by tin only, which is acting like a barrier, okay. So here mostly barrier protection, mainly barrier protection, so as well as look, okay, or the aesthetics. So there it will serve a fantastic barrier material for prolonged corrosion resistance, for providing prolonged corrosion resistance. Now these are in general a kind of distribution. Now if we try to look at the preparation processes, so or the application processes, paint of course it is basically a brass coated, okay, or maybe spray coated. You must have seen in a near the car painting segment, where we have a gun and that spray gun is actually coats the surface, and that painting has different processes, different material. For example, epoxy coating is one of the paints. There are different ways to prepare paint. For example, sometimes in the primer is very important, which is the first layer which is put on the surface, metal surface. So the primer should have a good adhesion to the surface. At the same time, it can serve different other purpose, like it can also serve as a cathodic, protecting agent towards corrosion, okay. For example, if we add little bit of zinc particle in the primer, so those zinc particle can act like a sacrificial anode and can give protection to the steel. Now it can also you can also incorporate inhibitors within the in the primer, so that inhibitor can also act for giving protection against corrosion, okay. So now that is the way we paint, spray coating or brush coating. Now, or even dip coating, okay. So in a paint bath, one big article can be, big plate can be dipped in and then take out and dry it, okay. Now in case of metallic systems or ceramic systems, we have to employ sometimes the high temperature processes. Now if we look at how many ways one can put coatings, okay. So at least if we look at ways to coat. Brush or spray gun or deep coating for paints, then for metallic coating one can use electroplating, where the substrate is cathode and anode is the material to coat. Sometimes we can use the electrolyte containing ions of metal, which is to be coated. So that time we use inert anode. Mainly we use platinum at times. Okay. So, these are electroplating. Now, electroplating, one is using DC power source, or we can also use so this DC power source can have two variations. Can you stop? Yes. So, in the DC power, when you use, one could be continuous supply of current, another one is pulse deposition. Fine. In the pulse deposition, what happens? We can have a small off period, and then you have a spike in the current, then off period, then spike. You design those off and on period. This is the current value, let us say this is the current value, off and on period as per the quality or the kind of coating we need. So, this is a pulse deposition mode. So, there we are actually using external power source. So, there is one more way what can be used for electro deposition. So, that is, we can say this is a subvariance. So, we can say electroless deposition. So, for example, nickel phosphorus coating can be made by, or nickel coating can be made by electroless deposition. So, let me just show you one example. Now, if you see here, this is actually a nickel phosphorus coating which is done by electro deposition, and here we are not using any external power source. This is done by by putting the steel substrate. This is a steel substrate in a bath containing nickel ions as well as phosphorus, the nickel phosphorus compound. So, those are actually getting deposited on the steel substrate, and if you see here, this is the coating part. The bright color is the coating part, and then the substrate is shown. And if you see the interface is very smooth. There is not much of waviness, and this can happen if the coating is done without giving a much of impact on the substrate. But if we try to look at another coating method, which is called HBOF, high velocity oxyfuel coating system. So, this is one of the coatings where we have put some amorphous coating on mild steel, and there what is done. So, we have a gun, and that gun is actually pressurized, that gun is actually having a kind of oxyfuel flame, and then you have a powder feeder. And then powder is placed in front of that high speed oxyfuel burner or oxyfuel flame, and that flame takes those particles in the molten condition, and then those particles are impinged on the steel substrate. And during impingement, there would be deformation on the steel substrate, and that is what, if you see here the interface, this is actually a kind of marker we have put. This is a marker put, but actually those are not there. It is just put up just to indicate what is the interface, where is the interface. And if you see that interface is quite wavy, because we have this, in this case those particles, those powder particles which are amorphous, which will convert into amorphous phase during cooling. So, those particles are forced or impinged on the surface. That is what those deformation has happened. So, this is one type of interface that you can experience. Then another kind of interface where we have actually used zinc coating. So, here zinc coating is done by dipping, hot dipping. So, here we have a zinc bath, and there the steel is placed, and if you see the interface, this interface is fairly smooth, but here what happens, there is a little bit of melting happening at the interface, and that is what you have little bit of waviness as compared to nickel phosphorus coating. Then we can also have one more coating, which is a chromium coating. This is a chromium coating. So, this is the chromium surface. And if you see the distribution of chromium, initially, of course, since outer surface is mostly chromium, so this is the coated surface. And then from the coated surface, if you go inside and map chromium content by doing EDS, okay, so then you can see that the chromium is decreasing, and then that is almost constant over the range of material or the range of the thickness, so which is actually getting into the iron substrate. So here what has been done, the chromium is coated on steel substrate. So now chromium has a diffusivity towards steel, and that's why the chromium, initial chromium layer is a very rich in chromium, and then the chromium gradually diffuses in, and then you have created two interfaces. So one interface, if you follow my arm, so this one interface, this which is chromium enriched zone, and then the chromium diffusion zone, and then finally you have iron zone, which is the steel substrate. Now this layer can give you a fantastic corrosion resistance, because the chromium can passivate and gives you gives you very good corrosion protection. At the same time, that chromium layer, that is also hard in nature. So that hardness or the strong nature of that coating also gives you very good wear resistance. That means it serves two purposes, fine. So I am just put some of the examples, okay. So in case of, electroless deposition, no electricity, smooth interfaces, smooth interface. So these are some of the advantages, and also very compact. Now, if you look at again, if you look at the compactness in case of chromium coating, you could see there are pores. Now, in case of amorphous coating by HBOF, which is high velocity oxy fuel coating system, you could see a lot of pores. Again, if you see a zinc coating, the interface, that steel interface and zinc layer, there are bit of discontinuity as well as pores. But if you consider nickel phosphorus coating, the interface is completely free of pores. So that means this becomes very compact. So the barrier effect would also become enhanced, fine. So and also this particular nickel phosphorus coating, what we have used, this particular coating system is basically giving excellent resistance to hydrogen diffusivity. So if you don't allow hydrogen to get access to the steel substrate, definitely the possibility of hydrogen embrittlement becomes very minimal. So, I just wanted to give some sort of flavor that how the coating interface as well as coating looks like. Now, electroless deposition, then we can have diffusion. Now, this is interesting that diffusion, whenever we have a high temperature processing, it is very difficult to avoid diffusion. For example, when you go for zinc coating, okay, or the galvanization, we always add a little bit of aluminium. So, that actually helps in avoiding iron diffusion into the zinc. So, that is a kind of inhibition layer that is formed. Now, there also there is a possibility, if you hold that particular sting longer time in the bath, definitely there would be counter diffusion of zinc as well as iron between each other. Within, for example, iron will diffuse into zinc layer, zinc will diffuse into iron layer. So, that is a possibility. And remember, if we have iron impurity in zinc, the corrosion resistance of zinc layer goes down heavily. Okay. Now, there could be possibility, for example, one such example is here. If you see diffusion part, if I look at chromium coating. So, this entire segment, which is basically, if you see from this end, if we look at the arm, that this end to the other end, the interfaces are very clear. This is the chromium layer, then you have diffusion layer, which is made of chromium diffusion in iron iron base. Okay, so this iron is acting like a solution. This is a solid solution, chromium in iron. Okay, so this is the diffusion bonding methods. So this is a that's what the bonding happens, and it's a strong bonding. So that's what we I always talked about that particular part, that the bonding between the substrate and the coating. If it is a diffusion bonded system, then the coating strength goes up very high. Okay, so it's very difficult to dislodge the coating. So here is, this is one of the instances where diffusion bonding or diffusion coating, you can also term it as a diffusion coating. Now then we can have spraying. For example, in this very example where we have put amorphous coating on top of mild steel, this is done by spraying. So what happens, you have a high speed flame, oxyfuel flame, okay, and that flame is actually carrying the powder particles onto the metal substrate. So this is actually, you are spraying those powders on top of the metal surface, and then you are creating a splat. We call it splat because of the high temperature of oxyfuel burner or the flame, that those particles melt, and those melt particle or the molten pool will be taken to the substrate, and then impingement happens. So during impingement happens, impingement, those small metal droplets, which is liquid now, will give you a splat on the metal substrate or the steel substrate. So that way it gets bonded, and then diffusion also happens there. So here also, if you see the interface, if we look at the distribution of elements. So this on the right side, you see the distribution of elements. This is done by EDS, area mapping. So there you can see that those elements are actually getting mixed at the interface. Okay. So this is one of the instances where we have used spray coating. Now we can also go for hot dipping. This is very common in industry, which is, for example, zinc coating. Then we can even use a chemical vapor deposition. Like polycrystalline silicon coating, that is done by chemical vapor deposition. We can have physical vapor deposition. Then we can have welding, cladding, those can also be used. For another one is a miscellaneous. So the miscellaneous is basically you can actually innovate and then make a separate coating process. For example, if we talk about the chromium coating, this particular chromium coating, what has been done? So first, if we see the process, this particular steel substrate, we put a chromium powder containing paste on top of it, and that powder contains, that particular paste is made with alcohol, okay? And then we let it dry. And when it dries up, that alcohol goes out, and the chromium will be very, very weakly bonded to the substrate. And then we do rolling. And after rolling, the chromium will be mechanically bonded to the surface, no diffusion now. And then we'll heat it at a higher temperature, around 900 degrees Celsius. At 900 degrees Celsius, what happens? The chromium will gradually diffuse into the metal or the steel, and then bonding happens. So this is actually a kind of innovation, like we have a roll bonding kind of stuff we have used. So this is another bonding method one can use, but you are also using diffusion here. But the initial part, how you put up the powder particles on the metal surface, there you can do a lot of innovations. So there are other techniques also you can make use of for having a better coating, right? So now these are some of the processes through which one can use coating. Okay. Now, these coating methods we can use for metallic coating, metallic or ceramic, So those can be put up, fine. As well as one can use glass coating. Many of this, for example, at least if we see this is all those methods can be applicable to metallic, but the ceramic, for example, one can think of a miscellaneous method for ceramic. Glass coating is basically putting a glass and then melt it, so that way one cannot spraying that melt over the steel substrate. For example, the chemical reactors, those are glass coated. And there the making of glass coating is, it follows a complicated process routes, but finally it is basically melting the glass and then spraying it over the entire surface. So that it completely covers at the covers of the steel substrate, fine. So that way one can use a glass coating. Now finally, we would like to talk about something on the selection of coating. What are the parameters that will guide the selection? Now, of course, one is cost and life up to which it gives you protection, then ease of maintenance, fine. Third is resistance to extreme climates. Like glass coated reactor for chemical processing centers or for chemical processing, then safety as well as health, minimum of health hazard, it should be minimum. So then we can also think of compatibility with the environment, okay. So these are some of the aspects one must look at. Of course, sixth is you can think of the application fields and choice of coating. That should be kept in mind, okay. And then definitely there could be processing. So, ease of processing, okay. So, we have looked at some of the aspects of coatings and also corrosion protection. Now, let us conclude the course, corrosion protection methods. And if you have seen over the last 40 lectures, we have started with the purpose of protection, and then we have also linked it to materials tetrahedron, and then looked at several aspects of corrosion protection, starting with materials, then environment, design, inhibitors, electrochemical potential of the metal substrate for corrosion protection, and then finally coatings. Hope you have gotten a good perspective of corrosion protection methods. We have also given a lot of examples. Hope those examples would be helpful for you. And remember, each aspect what we have talked about, each aspect can be separately looked at. Now, those you can actually go to those reference books and then look at it. But the basic principle is same. We have to have some mechanism to control corrosion, because it is impossible to stop corrosion. because the corrosion is thermodynamically spontaneous process, okay, because every element would like to get to its oxides or oxides or hydroxides or sulfides. So, those are basically natural processes. So, the metal would corrode. Now, we have to also see how to minimize that corrosion, so that we can operate that machine or that component, use that component for a longer duration. So, that should be the purpose. So, let us end here. Thank you very much.